glass containers. They're co-authored by Ranjan Ghosh and Jay Hillis Miller. This roundtable discussion will feature Ranjan Ghosh of University of North Bengal, Professor François Nudelman of University of Paris, Professor Bruno Clement of University of Paris, and Professor Birgit Kaiser of University of Utrecht as speakers. I request the speakers to come on to the dais.
Okay, good morning everybody. So glad to be here. And thank you to Ranjan Ghosh. It's an honor to be with you. And yes, I will unwrap this amazing book. Between Literature Across Continents by Ranjan Ghosh and Jay Hillis Miller.
Thank you, sir. Next book to be released is Transcultural Poetics and the Concept of the Poet, New York, Routledge, 2017, by Ranjan Ghosh. I kindly request Professor Birgit Kaiser to do the honors.
Thank you very much. Good morning, everyone. I'm also very happy to be here. And with great pleasure, wonderful book, Transcultural Poetics and the Concept of the Poet.
Thank you, ma'am. Finally, may I now request Professor Bruno Clement to release Ranjan Ghosh's Aesthetics, Politics, Pedagogy, and Tagore, London, Margaret Macmillan, 2017.
Good morning, everybody. I'm proud to be there too, and very thankful for Ranjan to be there. I'm very happy. It's not exactly my first time in India, but of course my first time in North Bengal University, and it's a great pleasure. So, I'm going to unwrap it. I'm about to. No surprise. Aesthetics, politics.
Thank you, sir. Now it's over to Professor Birgit Kaiser, who is going to moderate this whole round table discussion.
Thank you very much. I am extremely happy to be here. It is my first time in India, and I'm thrilled. And I'm also very grateful to Professor Ranjan Ghosh for inviting me and asking me to chair this panel. I think what we've agreed to do is that I will say a brief word about who is sitting in front of you and who will be discussing this book together, because I think that is important. Then I will say a few words about the book itself, and after that I'd like to open, of course, to the panelists, asking each of them for a brief statement, hoping that we can then engage in a conversation. We have an hour and 15 minutes, I was told, one hour. So I would like to have some time at the end also for questions from the audience to give you a chance to be part of this conversation. Okay, so without further ado, you will hear proper introductions of our speakers before each keynote. But I think it's important that Professor Roslan Hugelmann next to me here is Professor of French at the University of Paris 8. And he's also professor at the European Graduate School in Switzerland and occasional teachers in the US. This is important, I think, because we have a conversation of literature across continents, and I think we, so far the book has been a performance of an Indian and a US voice conversing, while on the panel now we do have three people who are situated more in European context, and I think it will be interesting to bring that also in. So an expert on Sartre and the links of literature and philosophy, and also an active radio producer. I'm delighted to have him here. To my left, Professor Bruno Clément, who is also a professor of French at the University of Paris 8, and who has worked on the theatre and Beckett. So I think, again, why I mention these things, I think there is a shared interest in the links between literature and philosophy, which has also come out very much in Ranjan Ghosh's work and in his contributions to the book that we are discussing today. Professor Ranjan Ghosh needs no introduction here, so I'm really skipping that. Now, there's two more people, myself. I am associate professor of comparative literature at the University of Utrecht in the Netherlands. I've worked also on the links between philosophy and literature. I guess that would be something that we all share, from which the question of reading across continents, I think, arises. And there is a fifth discussant who is here in form of his chapters and was just here virtually, and that is Philip Miller, of course. I think he is part of the discussion because his chapters are part of the conversation. Now, I think there are three, sort of thinking ahead to this discussion today, I think there's three lines that I see not only running through the book, but also running through the interest of all four that we are sitting here. I think they might be issues that come up in our discussion today. Now, one I've already mentioned, the links between literature and philosophy, from which I think all five of us, including Professor Miller, ask the question of what is literature. And I think we're all in different ways informed by Jacques Derrida's phrasing of it as this strange institution that has this bizarre position. While at the same time, I think also, especially Derrida in his book, Acts of Literature, which has the interview called The Strange Institution, is very particular about this being a quite Western form that he speaks about. So I think that is something to be considered if we talk about literature across continents. And it's also something that keeps coming up in the book itself. That's one line. The other line that I see running through all of our work, and which is why I introduced us also with our institutional backgrounds, is the institutional position that the humanities, and especially literature, has today. You've read the somewhat bleak chapters or analysis that Professor Miller gave of the future of the humanities in the US. And I think it's a quite different institutional position from which Professor Ghosh is speaking in his chapter and generally in his work. And yet again, our European situatedness, I think, is yet another. I think that's an important thing to remember if we speak about literature. Not only Derrida's reminder that in that term, it's a quite Western term, but also that depending on where you speak from, that changes what you speak about, perhaps, or how you speak about things. That is the second thread that I could see in this conversation. The third, obviously, coming from the title of the book, will be the transcultural. I think that is a concern, the global, the digital, how does that change everything that I've just said before. What is literature? Who speaks from where? Who speaks to whom? How fast do we connect what we say about? So those three lines I could imagine as elements of the discussion. Now we're discussing a book that is already a discussion. I think that's a very great aspect about that book, because it does what it says. It doesn't only speak about literature across continents, but it is a conversation across continents. And I would hope that we could expand on that here. There's five, you familiarized yourself with the book, of course, but there's five parts in it. The first one, looking at the matter of literature, what is it, but also why should it matter today? I think the question to contemporary is quite important. The second one looks at poetry, poems, and especially the effect that the digital has on our capacities of reading. I think poetry is a genre that is particularly vulnerable perhaps to digitalization, in the sense that our reading spans get shorter and shorter the more we can click on things. The third one, globalization, that's the third part, via the question of world literature. The fourth one, curricula and teaching, the question of the institutionalization of literature, where do we teach it and how do we teach it? And the fifth one is ethics. So I think it covers, the book covers a lot of ground, and it does so beautifully in a conversation. So let's try and expand on that and be faithful to its spirit in that sense and discuss across continents. Now my idea would be that Bruno Clément and François Nudelmann quickly have an opening statement on their reading experience of the book. I would personally be quite interested to hear their responses to the fourth part, that is, why do we teach literature today, and in what context do we teach it, and how do we teach it? But I'm only the chair and not the dictator, so you're free to speak in your response about what you like concerning the book, I think about 5 to 10 minutes perhaps. And then you, and then I would invite Ranjan to respond to that, and then we can move to the conversation.
Thank you, Vivian. I try to do my best, of course, and say three or four points before that discussion. The first one is the shape of the book, which is a dialogue. I think that every book, of course, is a kind of dialogue. Even is it better like that?
No.
Yeah, you are. It's better.
Is it okay now? Yeah. I can hear myself a little better. So, even when there's only one author, I think that a book is a dialogue. And this one is a real dialogue because, as they just said, one chapter is by Ranjan, one chapter by Dennis Miller, and so on. And it is a very pleasant way to read. Sometimes you agree with one, sometimes we agree with the other, sometimes we disagree with part of them, and it's very interesting to state our opinion in that way. That's the third thing. I would like to say that we tried, François Nudelmann and myself, to do the same once. We have written a book together, I showed in a few minutes. In the book, as Birgit said, there are three or four points that we haven't come, I think. I would take three now. Reading, interpreting, teaching. And I think it's more or less the 3 points that Ranjan has in mind when he says fusion, trans. Now, fusion is a layer saying reading for me, for my point of view. Transit, transcultural, yes, that's the point. Just that it said, and now it's up to God now that perhaps we can reflect about teaching. So about fusion, perhaps you know this afternoon I will have a lecture about Paul Ricoeur, and Paul Ricoeur says himself that reading is a kind of fusion, but he says something like a personal, individual fusion between author and reader. And he speaks about reading of fusion of horizons, two horizons, this the one of the reader, one of the author. Fusion is, of course, many times very often. Fusion is also fusion of culture. I can get that. I remember I said that is not my first time in India. I was in India in, I think, 206 for the century or so. And it was very interesting to speak about South French philosophy in India. Because perhaps you will be surprised to know that in 2006 for the century, there were not many things in France, but all around the world they were, and in India especially. And I was surprised to discover that Sartre is very well known, recently known in India, much more than in France now. Many ways to understand this now. First, the now of the writing, perhaps. When was the text written exactly? In what conditions and so on? But for me, the point is now the text is read now and taught now. So what is this now? I just think before going there to be again that my teaching now is quite different than what it was 20 years ago, even 10 years ago, I think. But why is it different? It's very difficult for me to say it. I don't know exactly. I have elements for answers, but I'm not sure. What is sure that it is different. And this now is very important. And if I may, because I said that now was linked for me with teaching, that my the kind of trigger for me when I'm teaching, I can find it in what says Alice Miller. I just quote one sentence: language is the matter. Language is the matter, not consciousness. Language is the matter. When I'm teaching, language is the matter more than consciousness. That's absolutely certain. And he says somewhere, I don't have the exact quotation, but Alice Miller says somewhere that for him, teacher, reader, the theory doesn't pre-exist. There is the text, then the theory, not the theory, then the text. I do agree with that. And I would say that perhaps we speak too about ethics, because it's a very important thread in the book. I think that if we speak about ethics in literature, we have to say the same. It's impossible for me, from my point of view, it's impossible to speak about ethics as if ethics pre-exists the text. Why read the text if we know already what ethics we are going to discover in it? So we read the text, and
perhaps history is going to change our opinion, to place it to, and ethics will be renewed by reading of every text. That's the main points. It's only to open the discussion. I don't know if anyone wants to pray for
it. Excellent, yes, on time. Thank you very much. I think we'll have lots to talk about. François Nudelman, may I ask you?
Yes, thank you, Birgit. As you said, yes, it's an amazing book, a kind of dialogue. I'm going to say it's a dialogue between two different readers. Sometimes they disagree, and that's why it's a very performative book dialogue. So it's about, of course, literature, but also I think about translation in a large sense, kind of transcontinental discussion crossing Asia, America, and as you say, Europe, because, well, we are here now to
continue.
Yes. Kind of third continent in this discussion. And that's an interesting discussion of perspective, as you said, Birgit. So the authors are both committed to the meaning of literature today. They speak about time and space, the now, as you said, the contemporary world, and also they reenact this, question, this issue of local and global. As Jean said, the more than global, we have to discuss about that, to go beyond the position or the articulation between the local and the global, and also the issue of Birgit this afternoon. So we have to question the literature as a cultural invention, from where, for whom do we speak, points of view, even if I have to say that we are not specifically identified writers or readers. I mean that I don't want to speak in the name of France or Europe, because we're not subject like that. You know, we are divided subject, and that's all the, I think also the, not all, but the purpose of this book, to think crossing, well, constantly crossing, we are crossed ourselves by many cultures, and that's perhaps the meaning of literature, you know, understanding the way we are constantly related to different cultures, even if, of course, we can get rid of our own culture, of course. And so that's why it's so important, as you said, Birgit, to be aware that we speak from our country, but the question is what does it mean crossing culture through literature or by reading literature? So I think that's what's really interesting, is this question, this matter of translation, the way Ranjan Ghosh introduces another word, and for us strange word for us, Sahitya. So playing, I would say that he doesn't play Sahitya against his other world literature, but as a kind of substitute or a double meaning that connects different literary traditions. So I would like to put, he said, he reminds us that Sahitya is derived from the word Sahita, united together. And in a way, united together, that's the meaning of continent. So it's continent, that in the world has been, contenere, holding, yes, holding together. Coming back to the quotation, the word Sahitya retains its Sanskrit origin, but is now commonly understood as literature encompassing poetry, plays, poetics, and other forms of creative writing. Although Salita means united together, this does not point to fusion or intermelding, but connection, the impersonation, a kind of being with, and also that's interesting person to do, that's Ranjan read a lot of French thinkers, and so being with, you know, comes from Jean-Luc Nancy's ontology, not being common, but just being with. So we have to think about the question of continent as holding together, or being together, or being with. What's the meaning of this with? Of course, the proposition, the main key word is crossing borders, crossing continents, because continents in, I think that in Russian's mind is, continents is infinite. Continent is a way of passing across countries by translation, and that's why also Bruno Clement said that trans is some keywords in Ranjan's thought, like infusion, crossing, trans, the now. And there is a, I would say that there is a politics of trans here, because trans is not only a question of coming from a country or a language to another. But that's the meaning of being with, crossing borders, and also a way to, and I think that's, that would be the main discussion between us, remapping, remapping cultures, remapping continents through literature. So that's why trans is a question of translocation by, for example, in poetry, by metaphors, because that's the meaning also of metaphors. And through this deconstruction of the, well, the nationalist's way of thinking literature, you know, the, that's why I say, well, I'm not speaking from a specific country, even if, of course, dated with my country. So there is a perhaps a first step to avoid this rooted conception of literature is first to deconstruct or destroy, even, because the Ranjan said thinking literature begins in destroying literature and experience of the impossible through excess singularity. That's why like to speak in the name of singularity and eccentricity. So his thinking across continents is a way to decartographize the question of geography, like in Deleuze's conception of geography and even geology, question of topology. I would have another question, perhaps? No. Do you want me to put everything on the table first? Or
I presume your question would be to Ranjan, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, but then you want to ask it, and then Ranjan can respond.
Yes, but my first question is, because I would like also us to discuss the notion of world literature, which is a very polemic question today, you know, it's world culture. Well, world literature. So, but first of all, I would like to discuss this notion of Sahitya, or I would like Ranjan to say something more about this stake of translation, well, so literature compared to Sahitya.
Yes, I think that could you a lot to respond.
Thank you very much, all of you. It's like very difficult, obviously, to talk about all these massive and
extremely capacious conference in a span of 10 or 15 minutes, but there would be a couple of responses that I might just like to summarize, or rather, impossibly trying to assess it.
Shaita is, when we were actually doing this book, Hillis and I, we spoke about how can we do literature. But I actually was thinking about that there are copious numbers of volumes on literature, literary thinking, across the literary market. So there was something that we wanted to do which would be different. Different in the sense that it would have, or rather make people think a little differently. The only way possible that we thought was to engage across borders, engage across cultures, engage across traditions, without in any way trying to influence each other. We thought that we can just about write two books, and which we did. I mean, we actually wrote two books, and then we started putting them together. Because what we wanted to do was to say that literature can have a context, literature should have a context, literature can have its own culture, should have its own culture, but there are something in literature that actually go beyond that. It is about saying that when you are trying to cross borders, you are already staying crossed. We wanted to bring about two discourses in play. One was, how can a literature be allowed, or how can literature be propelled to go cross borders? At the same time, the entire crossing is just not about involving an agency, or involving a kind of an operative momentum. It is also about how literature can really go across borders in spite of the fact it stays crossed. I always give a kind of a metaphor for this, and the metaphor is about how one can really visit a pilgrimage, or one can really go into a pilgrimage. And that is about when someone actually begins to undertake a journey as a pilgrim. Now there are two points that the person can take up. One is that he really has a site, which I say S-I-T-E, and he also has a sighting of the site, that is S-I-G-H-T. And when I say that, what I mean is that once the pilgrim actually reaches the site, it's S-I-T-E, and he decides to revisit the site probably after a duration of time, or a hiatus of time, then that site no longer exists. It is about the pilgrim now composing the pilgrimage. It is not about the site drawing the pilgrim to the point, but it's also about the site and the site coming together. In a way, the pilgrim now contributes to the pilgrimage, not that the pilgrimage really draws or, in a way, attracts the pilgrim on this journey. So it is in with the kind of a similar kind of a thinking that I began to do this. I mean, I told Hillis that you may write literature all through this book, but I will not write. I will say Shaito. Now, he said, obviously, he asked me what you mean by that. I said that the Sanskrit origin of this word actually goes back to Shohit, and that is about bringing things together. Now, bringing things together also means not just getting together, but togetherness. These are two different sensations that literature can bring. So, what I told him that I want to establish this word Shaito in, of course, in tandem with the way the Western discourses write on literature. So all throughout this book, I haven't italicized it. I have just written Shaito. So whoever reads the book, I mean a Western reader for instance, would actually, after a point of time, going to the middle of the book, would recite that Shaito and literature, they are almost synonymous terms. Now, what it does is that it does a kind of a double irony to it, because once you start to synonymize the two terms, literature and Shaito, then what happens is already in your mind you are crossed. Because now Hillis writes back to me and says, so this is the point about your Shaito. Now for the first time he writes me a mail, not writing literature anymore, he says Shaito. So within a few years, Hillis also realizes that well, literature and Shaito are synonymous terms. They are co-planar terms, they are co-evolving terms, they are co-extensive terms. So what generally becomes very interesting for me is that this is the crossing that we were talking about. And what is very interesting again, since Fossier was talking about the across point, when we saw the book, I liked it. Because when Duke brought it out, they just kept thinking literature continents in
in bold, but this was very subtly highlighted across. Now, this was not instructed. I mean, they did it on their own, the copywriter did it on its own. So it really shows that the spirit of the book really embeds in the whole idea of that cross. So one part was that. The second part was that when I'm actually talking about Shaito and literature, they might just conceptually, or they might, somewhat paradigmatically, they might just about come together in terms of showing the kind of vision, showing the kind of objective, showing the kind of aim that these two words really have. But the problem remained about translation. And what was very interesting for me is that when we were doing this chapter, which Birgit was actually telling me about this teaching part of it, was that it is always so difficult to teach literature in a classroom. For the very simple reason is that I teach English literature to earn a living. Now, when I do that, every time I enter the classroom, I have a lot of difficulty because in an English department, I cannot teach Bengali texts. So I really have to read texts which are translated from German or French, or they are typical American or British texts. Now, when I do that, the greatest difficulty that I face was that I have to teach Wordsworth's Daffodils to my students. So when I'm teaching a poem, Daffodils, to my students, the first thought that the student might ask is, have you seen a daffodil, sir, on your own? I mean, that's the first question they can ask. What is that? I say, it's a flower. What does it look like? I say, it's yellow. It's a small-looking, exquisite flower. But it is very important for you to see visually what the flower looks like. So what I'm teaching in the classroom is a poem which does not have any kind of an objective connection with the world around you. So what is happening here is that what are you teaching? You are actually not teaching the flower and the kind of responses that Wordsworth had about it, but it's a kind of a translated reality of the poem, or rather the flower that you are generally teaching. So somewhere I felt that we are just a few notches removed from the poem before we have already begun. So this was the first problem about translation. So I was thinking about what exactly can be the local and the global, because Fonsi was pointing out to this more than global thing. I'm just being very brief, might sound a little simplistic as well, but it's not as simple as what I'm actually trying to tell you. What I decided was that then what would be daffodils to my students in the class? Is it a local flower, or is it a flower which you can say international flower, or a flower from the first world? Now, this was the first question that I started asking myself. So what kind of a strategy, or what kind of a reading methodology should I have to actually communicate words and daffodils to my students? So I started rethinking the whole issue about the local and the global. And I personally have problems like with the word local and the global. Studies made in this regard are obviously relevant. Studies in this connection obviously are exceedingly thought-provoking. But I have certain problems with that, like I do have with world literature per se, because I have problems with the word world, which probably can take up a discussion later once the panel gets open for the floor. One problem I had, just to be very brief, is I decided that if there is a problem with the local and the global when I'm doing a poem, then can there be a category called more than global? Now, more than global is not post-global. More than global is not in the sense of a post-nation or not in the sense of a post-theory or whatever. It is a kind of an experience where the local and the global somehow gets trans-infused, where there is a kind of a changing of the places of the local and the global. And after a point of time, after you've experienced the whole work of literature, what happens is you start to decide how, which of the local and which part of the global are influencing each other. Is there a way that the local actually globalizes the global, as you call it, or is it the global that globalizes the local? So the whole problem about synthesis, the whole problem about two-directional movement changes, it somehow becomes an encompassive phenomenon, a kind of a momentum that starts to get generated from different corners. And so the whole thinking about literature that you make does not stay rooted to a point. The rootedness is there. I have never denied that in my book. The rootedness is there. Historicity is very much a part of our understanding and experience of literature and humanities per se. But also at the same time, it is important that this local and the global binary, the local and the global divide, starts to collapse somewhere. A melting away program, which I actually refer to more than global, which is also a part of Shahito, because that is how you do the Shohit, the togetherness of the local and the global. Probably I can keep it here and then we can take the later conversation.
Thank you, great. Well, I think there's lots that we could take up. I was particularly thinking now of your example of the daffodil coming out of your, you started by saying, if I'm teaching here, I always have to ask myself, which language do I teach in? So what literature is available to me because of certain linguistic restrictions or capacities of my students, and I felt very connected because I have exactly the same issue. I'm in the comparative literature department in which I'm not even restricted to English literature, but I could teach literature, and I do teach literature that is written in French, while hardly any of my students can read French. So I'm always, I always need to look out for those texts that are available in English translation or Dutch translation. So I think that, and Bruno Clément mentioned translation as one of the crucial sort of transformation machines in a way that can make texts available across continents or not, but then of course also raise all the questions that world literature has put on the table with its prominent investment in translation. Now the thing I was thinking about the daffodil coming out of my, okay, what language do I teach in, was that I thought me as a German native speaker reading Wordsworth, I didn't know what a daffodil was, and I thought the best thing about this is not what type of flower it is, but how it sounds. I think it's a fantastic word. So I think, of course, I absolutely think there is then the moment of, so what is, I mean, realizing that it is a flower, and what kind of flower it is, you go through that in your experience of reading that this flower so well described. But the attraction to me of the daffodil, I still don't exactly know what it looks like, the attraction of me to the daffodil is, it's a wonderful, it's a D and the double F, and it's a beautiful word. So, but on that note, perhaps I would be interested in maybe coming back to the question of ethics that you raised at the end, because it seems to me that's something you hadn't mentioned yet in your response. And I think that I would fully agree that the ethics is not a set of moral rules that we would have before we act, or that we would have before we read the text. It is something that develops out of the text, or that would develop out of the situation, in a way. Yet, I think there are fundamental assumptions that Hillis Miller, for example, will be making, and that you are making, namely, that it's sort of a proto-ethical act that I am paying attention to the text. And then I don't know what comes out of it. And I think that differs somewhat from your basic approach to ethics. So I was wondering, I mean, would you share that? I think also in Hillis Miller there is a strong sense of we must attend to the text. Then we don't know what happens, but the we must attend to the text, that's a very firm belief that he starts from.
You must distinguish between ethical reading I don't know exactly how to put it. Ethical reading or reading ethical texts. That's not exactly the same. You can read ethical texts. For instance, I had a discussion a few days ago with a Cognitive philosopher about the ethics. I would not say that nobody of my colleagues speak about ethics, but very few of them. The ethics, the factor is ethics, but they don't speak really about ethics. They are not an ethical reading of the ethics, which is the pathology of ethics. So it's only an example, but I think that we can think about that text may speak about ethics, but perhaps it is not the more important for ethics. Yeah, you know, gentlemen, get a discussion.
Coming back to the death words. Of course, I share this relationship to words, and I think that we have in common the fact that we pay attention to the words. That's the way we teach, you know. Not speaking about ideas, but even in philosophy, the way we are reading philosophical texts, you know, it's to pay attention, to take care of the sentence, the syntax, everything. Yeah. But I think that there is perhaps a contradiction between two things. On the one hand, we would like to give literature the credits of speaking of the world and grasping the world, and the question of ethics is involved here in literature, because regarding especially what Hilly Smirre said about now the fake news and post-truth, and that's terrible. That's terrible, but what? Does it mean that literature should tell the truth? I'm not sure that we would agree with that. So there is perhaps a contradiction between the fact that literature, on the one hand, is something that is very, in a philosophical way, very important to understand what happens in the world today. But on the other hand, we are in the realm of worlds, you know, just worlds. You know? And I think it's important, for example, to know exactly what a daffodil is, you know? Because if not, yes, that's the problem of worlds. And you know, in a way, that's also Wittgenstein critics saying that, well, we have some names, speaking about grass, for example, herbs, but in fact, we don't know what is the singularity of each, each flower, for example. Even daffodils is a general name. Just to say that when we say world literature, what are we talking about? You know, worlding. You say worlding. What does it mean, worlding? Because is it the same world than Welt? Or the same world than we say, we have no, you know, that's, we can't translate globalization, for example, in French, you know, it's impossible. So we say mondialisation, you know, mondialisation, because our world is mond, coming from the Latin, language, mundus, you know, so in Spanish, mundo, you know. Interesting, that's what we have to cross these languages to perhaps line sort of legalization of our mind to understand that, yes, there are so different meanings.
Chapter is called Lossi, and
globalization
and Lossi, and Jerry has done.
Yes. That's the meaning of because even mondialization, you know, we have in mind in French, mondialization, globalization, I mean, economic trade, you know, it's just trade. That's not a way of involving all the cultures. So it's a problem, you know, the fact that of course we pay attention to each world, but when we have to go across the different languages, perhaps we are lost, or we have the illusion of speaking the same reference.
Thank you, and I think what I forgot to say, that resonates with your experience also of teaching in the English department, I think, is that, and I'm more familiar with the Caribbean context, that of course writers have been very adamantly critical of the imposition of English imagination that comes along with the daffodil. That is also something, of course, one needs to take into account. Bruno, you want to add a few words to this one?
Only two words. Just one about globalization. I do agree, of course. And I would add one thing that it is for the third continent, it's perhaps much more difficult to think it or to have the right word for it, because we are at the beginning of the 18th century, the number of enlightenment
That's a cat. The first globalization. The first one. For us, it's a one thing that one thing of it. Because our tradition is enlightenment. It was considered as a good thing. Globalization, not so great. So, the company is there too. That's my first thought about globalization. The second is about literature. And Francois said, what is literature? Just my point. Perhaps we need a degree or someone on that. In every place where we pay attention to words, even if the text is not a literary one, we can read a philosophical text, an historical text, any kind of text. If you pay attention to this construction, to this verbal aspect, if you pay attention to the word before the concept or before ideas, then you do literature. You do literature. Even if the writer is not like a novelist or so on, but he uses words, so the truth, any truth, I don't know what is truth, but if you speak about truth, you cannot imagine a truth without words. So where the words are employed, where are words by writer, that's the best place to think truth. Even if you never get definition, you will never get a definition. But you will be closer.
I would like you to respond to some of these issues, but I would also like the audience already to think about questions. You decide what to do.
There might be some sort of questions already.
Yes. And congratulations to Professor Ghosh for your book releases. Now, it's not a question actually, but what I was wondering from the very title itself and the discussion that is going on, I think this, the very spirit of literature lies in the fact of helping people connect across borders, connect within borders, and along with that, retaining the plurality itself. It could be interculture, intraculture, in all senses. It's like connecting as well as retaining the plurality or the multidimensionality. So this is where I think that this is where the very essence of literature lies, and just your reaction on that. Thank you.
Well, I don't have to respond to this, but I would just say that yes, the whole idea of border and the whole idea of crossing, the whole idea of using geography as a kind of a vision, and the whole idea also that I've tried to bring out through this book, which I've called Heretical Geographies, is just to look at literature, just not through words, like Bruno was pointing out that words are so important, which I completely agree. I think it's words that give you the experience of literature. It leads you to a domain where you can do a formalistic, at the same time aesthetic, constructive thinking. At the same time, there are ways by which probably you can have some sort of an idea of a truth, even if truth is all the time a sort of an elusive phenomenon both together. But I also think, you know, that words, like the way Hillis was talking in the morning about kinesis, and I'm deeply influenced by this whole idea of the somaesthetics way of doing literature, or this kinetic or the kinesthetic way of doing literature, coming as it does from Aristotle. So what it does is that when we get to hear a word, as Vivid was talking about daffodils, this doesn't really stay as a kind of a local British flower. or we are not really concerned about the whole texture, the nature, the taxonomy of the flower as such. But what we are interested in is that it becomes a flower that becomes a kind of an aesthetic experience. Aesthetic experience now concentrically moves out to give us a feeling about what is literary aesthetics. From literary aesthetics, it leads us to imagination. From imagination, it develops a kind of an ethics of understanding the flower itself, which no longer stays as daffodils. So somewhere we have a kind of an experience where concentrically we start to move out of the daffodils, which probably Wordsworth saw, like what we get in Dorothy Wordsworth's journals, where he mentions that this is the day where we actually got to see this huge multitude of daffodils. So the daffodil as a poem, after we have had our reading done, the words, the experience, the semantic and the post-semantic both, it does try to create a kind of a world beyond the daffodils. So what it does is that, as Fossey was talking in the beginning about being with, the being with also becomes a part of the being without, out in parenthesis. So it becomes a kind of a being with and a being without. So it is a way of transcending the daffodils in a way. So I think the whole idea of a British imagination reading daffodils would have a different ethics to it. Much in the same way someone like me, someone like Fossey reading it, would have probably have seen it in a British flower, would have a different aesthetics of going to it. So it is just not about a poem leading you with words, or a text leading you with words. Sometimes it does happen that we have some sort of a preconceived, preformed ideas with us, with which we get into a poem. Because I'm reading my daffodils and I don't know what it is, I only know it's a flower. So someone with a British imagination will have a more particularistic idea of the poem before he or she moves into it. So these two ethics will be different. And it is the word which conveys a sense to me, but conveys a meaning to a British imagination. So the sense imagination dialectic also comes into play.
First of all, congratulations, Ganjan, particularly on this book with J. Hillis Wheeler. It's a pride of the department and, of course, of the whole university. I have a different take on the flower named Daffodil. When you refer to the flower, to me, primarily means or suggests the optical and the sensory, which subsequently fires up your imagination, you write a poem, and definitely it can be read across continents. But when I refer to the farmers of an Indian state who have recently committed suicide and are demonstrating their frustration and protest in the national capital of our country, right? Then it is a lived reality in a more encompassing manner. I wish one could take this kind of context, because Hillis Wheeler also spoke a lot about our political, historical, cultural, social differences, specificities, and realities. After all, this could take along this context parallel to transcontext, almost in the same page, right? That is one. The other is, I have a couple more questions. Thank you very much. And then I come to your etymological play around the word Asia. I hardly looked it up on the net. Your source and mine get down to the same source of, same set of root words. I find basically two. One is of a Semitic origin that you have picked out, Asu, referring to rise, etc., light, sunrise, so land of the sunrise. But there is also another word of the Asian root, which phonetically sounds almost my namesake, Asis, A-S-I-S, which means, on the contrary, muddy, silty. Why did you choose Asu over Asis? Because there's a lot of controversy about, you know. So there is that arbitrariness or selective choice. You have referred to Jean-Luc Nancy through another critic in your introduction, and there the word Europe derives from Europa, the Greek word wide-eyed, Thundery, it suggests a lot of history to this wide-eyed Thundery, right? But at the same time, Lugnansi takes into consideration the pre-Greek word ereb, which means obscurity. So looking far into its own obscurity, but its asu over asis, then I have some problem with the application of the Indian theory of rasa, I mean, to the reading of literatures across the world, because part of it, very significantly, is deeply steeped in casteist, anti-woman, and classist biases, right? For example, if you refer to the rasas, there are rasas and states also, bhavas and rasas, sentiments and, you know, states. For example, Sringara, originally it refers to the play between Lord Shiva and Parvati, but gradually the focus concentrates on the word Rati. Rati, centering on and around the female body. Maybe, you know, the erotic is located there. And then Vibhatsa. Vibhatsa, which refers to women and persons of inferior types. And Ananda is a state of disinterested interest. And if you go to Sri Aurobindo's reading of Ananda, Aurobindo doesn't want to let anything suffering or savage into it. Now, with this concept of Ananda, how do I read the realities of the worlds today? And then lastly, to your Frost's intended meaning, after all that we have done over the last 100 years or so, intended meaning. Because if you read intended meaning in the perspective of Indian philosophy and aesthetics and linguistics, then you have to go to the Spota Vyakarana school, where language is semantic holism. It's indivisible, non-compositional. But the Spota school of Vyakarana was challenged, seriously challenged by the Mimamsa and the Naya schools. They look into compositionality, which comes pretty close to structuralism later in Western linguistics. So, this view. Thank you.
Yes, yeah, I'll try to. The first thing is that it's very important that before we actually look into the Gnosi thing, where you talk about the obscurity in Europa, it's very important to read that particular essay in full. That is what Gnosi wrote, because it is a kind of Rudolf Garsche actually talking about that particular essay. And he's trying to bring into the whole idea of obscurity in a very different way. One is that something that goes away from your vision, something that moves away from your seeing, and the other is something that you cannot locate. So there are two things that the obscurity really wanted to say. One is that Europe was actually being obscure to what it is. At the same time, Europe was left obscured from the things that it wanted to see. So there was a movement that this essay tried to generate, which I picked up. Now that's moving to the whole Asia part. The reference that you make about Ashis, I also knew about that. But the point is that since I have begun with Gnosi, I could not have stayed with Slush, as you mentioned. So I really needed to look into a kind of a momentum that I can generate with Gnosi, because the whole idea of it was to make the matter of literature as a kind of a process, a kind of a mattering. So the mattering began with Gnosi, so I had to choose that part of Asia where there is a sun rising. And I had to do that with light, because Gnosi mentions the question of light in that particular essay. So that whole connect was about, or should I say, a kind of a photometric connection that I wanted to choose. So what did I choose with light was that the Asia being the continent which actually gets the light first, and that particular light goes to Europe. And once it goes to Europe, the light comes back to Asia. I was being very metaphorical in my way of reading, obviously. That is very evident. So what I was trying to say, that a light that Asia gets probably would have a kind of a pristinity to it. You're getting a first idea. Once that line goes to Europe and comes back to Asia again, there is the contamination almost under radar way, but keeps coming back to Asia. So the light that Asia gets again, or rather the light that revisits Asia, is not the light that Asia got first. So the whole concept of originality, pristinity, it completely gets muddled up. So that's the point I was trying to make about the movement. The second question is about Rosho. And the Rosho that you mentioned is absolutely okay, because Natashastra is also that. I have read my Natashastra, and I know that how exactly the Rosho communicates with different states of emotion, and how those states of emotion relate objective correlatively to your groundedness, to your situatedness, or to the world that exists around. But here, the Rosho was primarily about the emotion. Because if one reads very closely the commentaries on Natashastra, then not only do you get the correspondences that worldliness or worldness or groundedness brings, but also at the same time, the emotions that really come out of Rosho, they were something that I was trying to look at. What kind of emotion? The sentiments that Rosho is very much a part of how you do Shaito. Shaito exists because there is Rosho, like a very important philosopher of Rosho being Ram Ranjan Mukherjee. And Ram Ranjan Mukherjee has this very interesting idea about how literature can only survive with Rosho. Now, even if you go back a little towards the 18th or 17th or 18th century with Obinava Gupta and Ananda Vardhan writing on Rosho, because they were passing commentaries on Natashastra, the whole project was about how literature can only survive with Rosho. Rosho and literature are intertwined, inseparable, and all the same time, foundationally complementary. So that was the other side of it. And I forgot the other question that you asked me. Yes, what was that I used to got? That's late. Well, that comes to me as a thought which I would say is a shock factor, an Edwardian shock for me, because Farmer and the Foibles, I cannot think at this moment, because when I was writing this, it was primarily literature that I was doing, and I didn't really think about how ground realities or the events that are happening around me can really be eventful in my doing of literature. So that part obviously comes into play. And the last part was Sfota. Yeah, Sfota. I mean, it's if you're the linguistic theories, I mean, this is not the right forum to really be elaborate, but if one actually talks about philosophy of language, primarily from the Mimamsa school, and primarily from the Naya school as well, then Sfota is where the whole origin of the Bach comes from. So Sfota is being looked at from two very interesting perspectives in Indian philosophy of language. One is Sfota being a kind of a metaphor, a kind of a languaging, that's the way it's looked at. And another school looks at Sfota as a kind of a shock, as a kind of an emergence of a new idea that hides behind the words. So one is the way how words reveal, the other being of Sfota is how the almost a kind of a Heideggerian unconcealment that comes through the words. So Sfota is being looked at from two perspectives. My case was both. I would look at both. I could not be so detailed, but the intralinear narratives of my book tell me there were two things I had in mind. And that was, you talk about structuralism, which you're completely right, because that actually comes from the languaging of Sfota, the languaging momentum of the potential that Sfota has. And the other being that this question of unconcealment that I'm talking about, how words can be at times a bit elethic in nature, that's the term also I picked up with Frost. So when I discussed Frost in this book and I was thinking about Burgess, Burgess comes with two Sfotic meaning, one Sfota being the metaphor, the language, the structural, the linguistic, and the other was how language in a way defeats language to produce meaning. So
there's a tremendous elasticity in the words that we are using, like ethics, aesthetics, ideology, and I feel that, you know, like the way a creative writer also feels, like, you know, whether I should use a word like pot smoker or doing grass at this moment or a gajakhor, you know, like if I can collate these three words together, which one I choose from. In an earlier lecture, you had mentioned that, you know, like the very art of cannibalizing, pick and borrow and choose and everything. So I find that, you know, like studying literature and doing literature, perhaps there's a kind of a correlation that you're trying to establish here. So that's a kind of a compliment that I give. And the question that I have is a very short technical one. Like, the blurb of your book mentions that there are certain points, areas where you disagree with Miller, but it's very briefly mentioned. So I'd like to know, you know, like, in a nutshell, the disagreement areas.
I was just trying to ask that the same problem I also face while teaching my students, like regarding daffodils, one thing I think which is communicable across culture is the experience of loss. Because if you remember the last stanza of the poem, that it is about remembrance and the object is lost. So I was thinking the kind of transness you are talking about, can we think it in terms of loss? Because then it can counter the humanist discourse of a kind of comparatism which assumes a common human essence across culture, which many, including Derrida himself, has deconstructed in essays like The End of Man and others. So that is my question.
Very, very quickly, almost in one sentence, if I can. I was just wondering whether we could consider Sahitya in terms of the word itself as an inherently ethical term.
It is not exactly the connotation of the English word literature, because again, if we consider the ideas of being with, whether it is a Nonsian term or whether it's a Levinasian term, there is an ethical idea of being with someone. And in that sense, maybe I'm simply talking about something which is already there in the book, but because I haven't read the book, I was just wondering whether Sahitya can be mobilized as an inherently ethical term, which is slightly different from literature. Thank you.
And the last
one, I have two questions. The first one, we know that any attempt at crossing operates in a contingent space. Now, in relation to that, how could you view literature dealing with this? And the second part is, how does literature deal with the question of ethical and the impossible? And in relation to the immediacy of addressing or reflecting what is here and now. In other words, how does it deal with, according to you, the questions of the immediacy and visibility of what is and the ethical imperative of what should be and what can be?
Thank you very much.
One thing that I would like to respond to Orko's question. Orko has actually just picked up the right thread, because I did not do Sahitya like the way Hillis does literature. And there is a definite ontological, performative, operative difference between how you look at Sahitya and how you look at literature. Because you cannot ignore the Sanskritic origin and the way Sahitya as a word has unfolded over the years or has got appropriated or under-appropriated over the years. So for me, I'm ready to take the debate later, for me, Sahitya is a more encompassive term than literature. Because if you look at it etymologically, and if you look at it the whole tradition, like the way it's being done, I think there is much more need for literature to somehow cohabit and enjoy the colonial cousinhood of Sahitya a lot. Because that would probably help literature to somehow to generate a different kind of a space, enabling probably the threats that come institutionally to close down literature departments or anything related to humanities per se. So Sahitya for me is still something at the back of my head. I really wrote literature. It's a book which says literature. But Sahitya came to me more as an erotic term. a term that has more eros to it in a sense that it has more reach and reachability, and more of its doing with the impossible that probably literature could not have thought out. So I think that's why. And coming to the loss, I completely agree. That's the loss aesthetics that I've worked on. And the loss is so genuine, because without a kind of a loss, there cannot be a winning goal ever created. And literature's loss is not literature's ruin that way, because it's a kind of a loss that generates the kind of a citadel of literature, the enclaves of literature. It's a more of an epitomization of literature that comes through the loss that you generate in terms of translations, in terms of thought, in terms of your cultural thinking, in terms of the kind of a meditative thinking that you do on literature per se.
Everyone on the panel, everyone in the audience, and just looking from my perspective here, I mean, I understand all the institutional worries about literature and the humanities, but being such a full house, on a literature conference, I think it's great.